All right, we'll get started in just a moment. If you want to, if people want to come in, we've got plenty of seats throughout the room. All right, well, thank you everybody for coming today to our seminar on Investment Assets and Inequality, the Role of Capital Taxation. I'm Greg Leiserson, the Director of Tax Policy and Senior Economist here at the Washington Center for Equitable Growth, and I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker, Ignacio Gonzalez. Ignacio is an assistant professor of economics at American University, and today he'll be presenting new research looking at rising income inequality in the United States and the role of lower capital investment, higher asset prices, and their relationship to changes in capital taxation. Just a few notes before we start. First, the seminar is on the record and will be live streamed. We will start imminently. We'll save about 15 minutes for Q&A at the end of the seminar, starting about 1:15. But you can ask questions throughout with a slight bias for questions of clarification and shorter questions during and longer questions at the end. And also, our next seminar will be June 20th with Heidi Williams, Associate Professor of Economics at MIT, who will present her paper, Who Profits from Patents, Rent Sharing at Innovative Firms, which was partially funded through the Equitable Growth Academic Grant Program. And with that, I will turn it over to Ignacio. Thanks so much for joining us.
Well, thanks for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'm going to present today a joint work with Lydia Brun, who is my colleague at the Free University in Brussels. And so we are going to talk about aggregate tolling skew, rents, like monopoly and monopoly rents, and capital taxation, and how this has affected the evolution of investment and the evolution of inequality. Factor prices. So, back to 2014. Like, I'm pretty sure that you are familiarized with Piketty's work. He basically had two empirical findings. So, he basically showed that the capital output ratio had been rising in advanced economies, and that the capital share of output had been rising too during the last decade. Okay. So at that time, in 2014, 2015, and even today, the debate was very focused on the value of sigma. Okay, so to have like a joint rise of the capital output and the capital share, so Piketty assumed that sigma had to be larger than one, and many people at that time said that probably sigma was lower than one in our model of production function. Okay. And this was the parameter that was in which the whole debate on Piketty was pretty much centered. Oh. So, but Piketty and Subman in his paper Capital is Back, they actually emphasized that the wealth income ratios, I mean, during that period, had risen a lot, mostly due to a huge asset price recovery. Okay, in the housing sector and in the stock market. And this received less attention. Okay, so we had at that time other alternative theories, like for example, financialization theories, or people like Rawthon, who wrote, in my opinion, a very nice note on Piketty's work, who had been saying that during the same decades, the asset prices had been rising a lot. Okay, the stock market value had been rising a lot, but investment had been declining, okay? I mean, and this could have happened for many reasons, but what these people emphasized was like, okay, firms have had the strategy of maximizing shareholder value, and it was occurring at the expense of corporate investment. So here we focus on tolling skew. Why tolling skew? Well, aggregate tolling skew is a variable for the corporate sector that captures very well the relation between the wealth income ratio measured by the stock market wealth, okay, and the capital output ratio, okay, capital in terms of productive assets, okay, in the corporate sector, okay. And what we observe is that, like, and also it's something that is shown by Piketty and Subman in his paper, in their paper, what we observe is that for advanced economies, tolling skew had been rising during the same period, okay, in which inequality has increased a lot, okay? And this increase in tolling skew, this increase in the stock market value relative to productive capital in the corporate sector was not coming with an increase in investment, okay? So what we argue in this paper is that we cannot assume that tolling skew is equal to one, okay? During this period. This is something that Piketty and Subman did in the paper and Piketty in the book, well, for tractability reasons, for measurement reasons, but we cannot assume that tolling skew is equal to one and use wealth, stock market wealth in the production function, first because it's an output of the production process, and second, because if you use wealth in the production function, you might be conflating price effects with quantity effects. Okay, you might have an increase in wealth because tolling skew is rising, Q is rising, or because capital is rising. Okay, this is a measurement problem. What we say in this paper is something else. What we say in this paper is that tolling skew has been rising during this period, and the increase in wealth might have crowded out capital formation. So this increase in Q might have had a negative effect on capital, okay? And this, well, this has huge implications for inequality, okay? Because if wealth, if stock market wealth is rising, I mean, people, owners of stocks are going to benefit from that. But if at the same time this has a negative effect on investment, I mean, we are going to have a problem in terms of growth and also in terms of wage growth, okay? So we try to show in this paper is that the rise of aggregate tolling skew reflects in reality, I mean, the role of certain pro-capital policies, okay? And therefore, they cannot be ignored in a debate about inequality, about growth in during the last decades. And we study the effect per se of tolling skew, but then we analyze, okay, what are the potential drivers of tolling skew during this period? Okay, and then we focus our analysis on the role of capital taxation on rents because we think that they are natural candidates. And we are going to do this, I mean, we do this in this paper using an heterogeneous agent framework. Okay, well, an heterogeneous agent framework is like, in our opinion, is the natural environment in which monopoly power should be studied. Okay, if we have a theory where a stock market wealth due to monopoly power is rising a lot, okay, this is in the benefit of stock owners, and at the same time we have capital and investment falling, and this is affecting wages and job creation, then this is going to have a huge effect on the wealth distribution and the income distribution. Okay. Okay, so this is the main, the figure of the main variable of our paper. This is aggregate tolling skew. I mean, we use different measures. We use the standard measure of aggregate tolling skew, and some others. Basically, they all show this ratio, the ratio between financial wealth and unproductive capital, according to the estimates that we have. And what we see is that there is an increase after the 80s, okay, a secular increase after the 80s, okay, up to the early 2000s, okay, this is the dot-com bubble. And then we find that the tolling skew is more or less stable after the stock market bubble, and this decline is the recent recession.
Second?
These are US numbers, yes. But tolling skew has been rising. So what is interesting is that tolling skew has been rising in advanced countries. And what we find, I mean, in another paper, what we find is that the sources, the drivers of tolling skew, I mean, are like stronger in countries like the US, where Toynsky has risen more than, for example, countries like Germany, where it has also risen but less. Okay. So if we go and see what is behind the rise of Toynsky, behind the rise of this ratio, Toynsky is not only the stock market wealth over output, okay? It is in reality equity wealth, okay, which is stock market wealth, over the replacement cost of capital, the productive assets evaluated at market value, plus financial asset minus non-equity liabilities, okay? This is corporate debt, okay? And what we see is that, I mean, what we see is that the rise of Toynsky is mostly driven by the rise of E over K, okay? And the, because the evolution of financial assets and non-equity liabilities is more or less parallel, okay? So we don't try to explain this gap, okay? We will focus our analysis on the rise of equity over capital, okay? Assuming that financial assets and non-equity liabilities are the same, okay? And we will focus our analysis also on the non-financial corporate sector, okay? We have, I mean, there are some particularities affecting the financial sector, and we don't find, and we think that our model is not convenient to study the financial sector, okay? So, when we look at the numerator and the denominator of Toynsky, what we find is that the, on aggregate, periods in which the denominator has been falling, okay, which is the blue and the blue for the non-financial corporate sector, the light blue, this one, are periods in which the numerator, the stock market wealth, has been rising, okay? And then this is clearly the case after the 80s, okay? We see an expansion of the numerator, the stock market wealth, the blue, the dark blue, okay? And at the same time, there is a decline in investment at least after the mid-2000s, early 2000s, okay? If we look at this, if we look at the evolution of investment, okay, we also find that after the 80s, the growth, I mean, for different figures of investment, the growth rate of investment after the 80s is lower than the growth rate of investment before the 80s. Okay, so this is the evolution of gross investment to output, okay, and this is the evolution of net investment to output and capital, okay. If we take averages of these figures before and after the 80s, we see that the numbers after the 80s are below, okay, and this is consistent with the evolution of stocks. I'm saying this because we have good indicators. I mean, we have the stock market wealth. Okay, this is something that we can measure very well. But I mean, many people discuss or consider that the available measures of capital stock are not precise enough. I mean, we understand that. I mean, that's actually the reason why Piketty and Schumann, in their paper, Piketty in the book, use the numerator, okay, as capital, because he prefers to use something that is priced at market value and easily identified than some estimate of a capital stock, okay? But what we have, I mean, at least our available estimates of capital stock indicate that when the numerator is rising, the denominator is falling, and the opposite. And we have, and this is consistent with the evolution of investment flows.
So, yes. So, as you say, measurement is very important in these things. Are these ratios done in current prices, constant prices? I assume capital is at replacement cost.
Yes, this is at current cost. Okay, so this is a price. This is capital evaluated at market value. Okay, so the Bureau of Economic Analysis also offers data on capital at in real terms. Okay, this is, I mean, and they say they use like chain indexes. So I have the figure here. If when you look at the variable in real terms, okay, you have to. I mean, because you are like measuring two variables that don't have the same unit, you need to use the log. And we find something that is very consistent with our story. We find that the capital output ratio after the 80 declines, right. And then we have, I mean, much lower after the 80s. Okay. Again, I don't want to claim that the use of our paper is like a theory. We propose a model to rationalize what has happened after the 80s, okay? And to rationalize this data, we don't. We use the data that is available, okay? But as I saw before, investment data flows are pretty much consistent with the story of stocks.
The standard story about this decline between about 1980 and 2000 is that it's driven by technology, the shift toward information technology, the personal computer revolution. So that's just lowering capital costs. That's the standard story. At least that's one story I've heard about that decline.
I mean, this is so here what you have is if the capital output ratio is falling, it means that the productivity of capital has been rising. Okay, this is for me is not surprising, but you see today many papers where they claim the opposite, that the capital output ratio, and actually, I mean, if you use the data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the capital output ratio that they have presents a growing trend because they assume like some price methodology different to the proof. I don't want to enter in details, like we can discuss later, but. Okay. Okay, so we have this data. So we have the stock market wealth has been rising, and our measures of productive capacity, either in stocks, capital, or inflows, investment, has been growing at a lower rate than the stock market wealth. Okay, so suppose that we want to explain these aggregate facts, okay, with a very simple graph. So I propose the following capital market graph, okay? So this is the market for capital. This figure is an output from the model. I'm going to explain now how we get this figure. But basically, we have that the red line is the capital demand, okay? Which comes from the problem of the firms. Firms demand capital, physical capital, okay? And then the purple is the supply of capital, okay? Which comes from the household sector, okay? So the household sector supply capital to the firm sector. So in a standard macro model, okay, the equilibrium is found at the intersection. The capital market equilibrium is found at the intersection between these two schedules: the capital demand and the capital supply. Now suppose that we have a financial economy, okay, like a realistic, a more realistic economy, okay, where households, instead of supplying physical capital to the sector, they own financial assets, the stocks, okay, and the investment decisions and capital accumulation is taken inside the firm. In that economy, the equilibrium, if tau in Q is equal to 1, would be the same. Okay, you can prove that, and there is a perfect mapping between one type of economy, the financial economy, and and an economy where households accumulate capital. Now, but suppose that tau in Q is not equal to 1, like we had before the 80s. Okay, tau in Q before the 80s was lower than 1. Because the denominator was bigger than the numerator, okay? Then we have another schedule, which is the market value, the equity value of the capital demanded by the firm, okay? The stock market value of the corporate sector, okay? Which is this blue schedule,
Now, because households care about the financial value of their stocks, the equilibrium in that type of economy is going to be at sea. Okay? And the price that is clearing this market is this one. But the corresponding capital that is generating this return is given by B. Okay? So in this equilibrium, okay, we have an economy where the stock market wealth is low relative to the physical capital, okay, and equity returns are low. Now suppose the Tobin's Q increase and it goes from values lower than one to values close to one or equal to one. Okay? Then the gap between these two schedules is going to close because both lines are going to overlap. Okay? So the difference between these two is one minus Tobin's Q times the capital output ratio. Okay, so if Tobin's Q is equal to one, then the difference is zero. And the two lines overlap. And the intersection, the equilibrium, is going to be given by A. So what happens during that transition? Well, during that transition, what we have is that the stock market wealth relative to output is going to increase. Okay, we're going to go from here to here. But the capital output ratio, the productive capacity, I mean, not the productive capacity, the amount of capital relative to the output, okay, produced by the economy, is going to decline. We are going to go from here to here, okay? And then we have perfect overlapping between the two schedules.
This is for an isolated closed system. What happens if you have FDI? Because you're not longer having to make between households and investments.
I mean, I mean, if you have like foreign investment, then. There is not going to be a perfect equilibrium between the demand of capital and the supply of capital because you have capital flowing from outside. But I mean, this is a representation of the model, and we are going to see how this model explains the data. Okay. Okay. So we have this type of transition from this equilibrium to this equilibrium, and the question is, okay, this transition would be like a representation of what had happened if the return to equity increase, okay, as we go from C to A, okay, if we go, so this is what we find, like when we adjust the return to equity to taxes, to inflation, and portfolio cost, what we have is that the equity return has increased precisely during the period in which we have that transition. Okay, so equity return has been increasing. So the price is moving like in accordance with the quantities. Okay, so we think that this kind of transition is what we have had in the US economy between the 80s and the 2000s. So that's why we call this a pre-1980 equilibrium and a post 2000 equilibrium. Okay. So the question is, what is driving that Tobin's Q? What is driving that change in the market value of wealth relative to physical capital in the economy? Well, we have two candidates. Okay, we have capital taxation, which has declined a lot during that period, and monopoly rents. Okay, and now we have a growing literature that shows that monopoly markups. And monopoly rents have been growing precisely during those decades. So we are going to we built a model where changes in the asset price are going to occur at the expense of corporate investment. So this creation of wealth, of financial wealth, is crowding out corporate investment, is crowding out capital. Okay? And then in our model, investment, okay, which is going to be higher when Tobin's Q is lower, and this is a little bit against those who are familiarized, those of you that are familiarized with Q theory, okay, you remember that basically what Tobin had in mind with the ratio is that, okay, if a firm has the market value of a firm is larger than the replacement cost of capital, than the value of assets, okay, of the firm, then the firm has an incentive to increase investment, okay, because the value of capital inside the firm is high, okay. But this is traditional. I mean, this was what Tobin was thinking when he proposed the Tobin skew, but this occurs when you don't have frictions like monopoly power, or when you don't have frictions like capital taxation, okay, which are going to alter the relation between the market value, the equity value, and the replacement cost of capital. Okay, so then our paper presents a conceptual difference to recent papers like, for example, Gutierrez and Philippon. Okay, so Gutierrez and Philippon, in a recent paper, they say, okay, that precisely investment, I mean, after the 2000s, investment has been low, despite high Tobin skew. Okay. But in our model, this is actually, it is not despite Tobin skew, it's because Tobin skew is high that investment is falling. Because we have this mechanism where the creation of the stock market, the rise of a stock market wealth is crowding out investment, okay? So stock market wealth not only reflects the fundamentals, it reflects like the monopoly rents or lower capital taxes, okay? Okay, so so we built on literature. So there is very good literature on this topic. For example, we have Siam has a paper in 2009 where he shows that historically there is a negative relation between taxes on equity and aggregate stock valuation. So this is an empirical paper. This is what is happening actually in our model. And McGrattan and Prescott, they study the same type of secular transition between the 70s and before the 80s and the 2000s, and they claim that the rise of stock market wealth relative to capital is produced by a decline in dividend taxation. Okay, the thing is that in McGrattan and Prescott paper, the economy is a representative agent economy, and they have complete markets. Okay. What does that mean? Well, it means that the supply of capital is completely elastic. So the price of capital in the steady state is fixed, okay? If the price of capital in the steady state is fixed, then in the steady state you should not expect any change in capital, and you should not expect any change in output. Because you have a representative agent economy, the wealth rises for the agent in the economy, and this is welfare improving. In our economy, this is not going to happen because we have incomplete markets and heterogeneous agents. What happens is that the stock market wealth is the rise of stock market wealth is only experienced by some agents. And in our model, because the supply of capital is not completely elastic, okay, capital relative to output is going to fall, and this has a depressing effect on wages and growth. Okay. So we also have this paper as a reference. This is an econometric paper where they, using an economy that is an heterogeneous economy, what they show for an income distribution that is close to what the U.S. income distribution, they find that the amount of capital, proactive capital in the economy is actually too low. Okay, why? Because there are many people in the economy. I mean, most of the people in the economy receive income from labor. Okay, so they are negatively affected by having low capital. Okay, and then our paper is also very connected to recent papers on monopoly power and its macroeconomic implications. For example, this famous Barkai paper, where he shows that the profit share has been rising when you calculate the capital share using borrowing cost. Okay, so our paper is going to be a bit different. I'm going to explain why we deviate from that. But then we also have this De Loecker and Ekhakut paper who show that markups, monopoly markups, have been increasing across firms and industries in the US economy. Okay, so our model is a financial economy with one tradable asset. Okay, what does that mean? Like, we have one tradable asset in the economy is going to be stocks, and the stocks are going to capitalize pure, like, monopoly and conventional profits. Okay. We think that this is a very important feature of our paper, and it's a realistic feature. Why? Well, in reality, when you do, for example, tax policy, you don't distinguish between conventional and pure profits, okay? You have a standard, like, corporate payouts, okay, that form the return from stocks. So in our economy, the pure profit coming from monopoly power, the monopoly rents, are going to be capitalized. Monopoly rents are going to be capitalized in the market value of stocks. Okay, and therefore we don't have this distinction that you find in some papers like Barkai paper between the capital share and the pure profit share. Okay, we have households that make a standard consumption and saving decisions under uncertain income, that save in stocks and pay taxes on dividends and capital gains. Okay, and then we have firms that, in a monopolistic competition setting, that own physical capital, and they invest, retain earnings, and distribute dividends, make investment decisions to maximize shareholder value, and pay corporate taxes. Okay. So these taxes, dividend capital gains and corporate taxes, plus monopoly rents, are going to create a wedge between the market value of firms and the replacement cost of capital. And inequality and factor prices are affected when you have a transition, like the transition I explained before, okay, when Tobin's Q increases. So how much time do we have? Okay, so we have a. I'm not going to spend much time on the model. I mean, this is a standard model where households maximize the lifetime utility. We use very standard preferences in monopolistic competition literature, the digital stiglitz preferences, and you have the household consume. They buy stocks. Okay, S at price V. V is the market value of the firms from which they own stocks. And they receive labor income with uncertainty, and then they receive dividends. They pay taxes on dividends, and they pay taxes on capital gains. Okay, and kappa is like a portfolio fee that plays a minor and a role in the paper, but a minor one. Okay. And then you solve this problem and you get the standard asset price formula, where the price of the stock is equal to the discounted flow of dividends, okay? Discounted by the discount rate, which is of course related to the stochastic discount factor of the problem of the households. And then we have standard firms as well. So we have firms that accumulate physical capital, and that because they are monopolistic firms, they internalize the demand of the product they produce, and they have a standard financing constraint. The firm pay dividends, invest, pay the wage bill, and pay the corporate tax. Okay. So when you solve the model, you manipulate the model, the maths, and then you get this expression for capital, okay, for the replacement cost of capital. Okay, this expression is simply saying that the value of capital is equal to the flow of dividends that is able to generate in the future, discounted, minus the monopoly rents. This term is the monopoly rent, okay? The flow of monopoly rents. So when you have no monopoly rents, because this elasticity tends to infinite in the model, okay, then this guy disappears, okay? And then you have that the capital is equal to the discounted flow of dividends. And then you are in the world in which tau is Q is equal to one, a standard neoclassical model. But when you have monopoly rents, then this guy is going to be lower than infinite, and then you have that this term is positive. And then capital is, the value of capital is the market value, the replacement cost of capital is lower than the discounted sum of dividends. Because if the firm sells that amount of capital in the market, then that capital is not going to be able, is not going to, so the capital, the value of capital is lower outside the firm because it's not able to produce the monopoly rent that produces inside the firm, okay? And then if we put together the expression for capital and the expression for the price of the stock, then we get this Tobin's Q, okay? And the Tobin's Q here in the States, it depends on the tax on dividends, on taxes on capital gains, and on the monopoly rent, okay? The monopoly rent in this time. So if the monopoly rent is zero because psi is equal to infinite, okay? And taxes are, and we don't have taxes, the taus are zero, then Tobin's Q is equal to one, okay? And then we are in that equilibrium in A, okay? Where we didn't have a wedge between the market value of capital and physical capital, okay? If, on the other hand, for example, taxes on dividends are, we have positive taxes on dividends, we have a positive monopoly rent, okay? Or if we have a tax on capital gains, then Tobin's Q is going to be different to one, okay? And this is what we have, okay? We have a transition, remember, between before the 80s and after the 80s, where Tobin's Q was rising. So the question is Tobin's Q being driven by taxes and by monopoly rents? And then when we see the evolution of taxes, this is the effective corporate tax rate, okay? We have that the corporate tax rate has been falling, okay? Between the 70s and the early 2000s. This is going to have an effect on Tobin's Q, because if we have monopoly power, okay, and if psi is not infinite and we have a monopoly rent, if tau is falling, then it means that you are rising this guy, you are rising the monopoly rent. So you are rising the Tobin's Q, okay? And the same happens with the taxes on dividends. These are effective taxes on dividends, okay? In the paper, we explain how we calculate effective tax on dividends and effective tax on capital gains, but we also see that there is a secular decline in these taxes before the 80s and after the 2000s, okay? And again, this has a depressing effect on Tobin's Q, okay? So tax on dividend is going to, the decline of in the tax of dividend is going to rise Tobin's Q. The decline of in the tax of in tax on capital gains is going to rise Tobin's Q, but taxes on capital gains are also here and they have a negative effect on Tobin's Q, okay? Okay. So this is, so we calibrate the model to compare the decade, the 70s and the, with the 2000s. And we use the model and say, okay, suppose that we want to explain the transition, okay, from a lower Tobin skew to a high Tobin skew. So we want to explain which part of the asset price, okay, of Tobin skew relative to capital is explained by the change in taxes, okay? And this is the part. So here, the asset price is rising, okay? Then the equilibrium asset price is going to be this, but because, but remember that when the asset price is rising, the capital demand, the demand of capital investment is going to fall, okay? So this is what, we go from this equilibrium to this equilibrium, okay? And then the remaining gap is explained by the monopoly rent. And also, the remember that the monopoly rent is interacting as well with the, with other taxes, with the corporate tax rate, okay? So we have an economy that is transiting from low asset prices, high capital output ratio, and low equity return and low inequality to an economy that is transiting to a new equilibrium that is represented by a high capital, a low capital output ratio, high asset prices, high inequality, and high equity return. Okay, and then we use the model and we explain to what extent changes in the capital output ratio, okay, which is the denominator of the Tobin skew, changes in the equity output ratio, which is the numerator of the Tobin skew. The Tobin skew itself, the return, the labor share, and the dividend output ratio, to what extent they depend on the taxes and the markups in the model, okay? And what we find is that the two main drivers of these big changes are the taxes on dividends, okay? Taxes on dividends has fallen a lot, so they basically have a positive effect on asset prices, but they have a depressing effect of on investment in this model, and not surprisingly, the markup as well. So the markup has an effect that similar to the dividend tax. So the capital output ratio, the markup is going to depress the capital output ratio. Okay, in the model, this is occurring through a rich general equilibrium effect. It is going to rise the equity output ratio, and it is going to rise Tobin skew, okay? It is going to rise the return, and it's going to depress the labor share, okay? So we have this decomposition analysis in the paper, with the contribution of each of the factors, okay? And then we use the model, because we have an heterogeneous change in the economy, we use the model to perform a welfare analysis, okay? In our economy, we have heterogeneous agents. So we have agents that differ in terms of their asset holdings. Okay, so this is the distribution of asset holdings. And we have agents that are uncertainty, that are uncertain relative to their income. So we have, in the steady state, we have agents that are high productivity agents, low productivity agents, medium productivity agents. So when we compute the welfare, with the change in the welfare in this economy, what we see is that relative to the 70s, okay, this is the vertical axis is given the welfare gain of the, and the welfare loss for the different agents in the economy, and what we see is that for the average population, there is a decline in welfare, and only those who have high asset holdings experience an increase in welfare. Okay. In terms of different agents, according to their productivity, and who are the guys that benefit more from this, transition? Well, the guys that benefit more from this transition are the low productivity guys that are very rich. So like the rentiers of the economy. So people that are not working, they don't depend on labor income, they only depend on equity returns and returns from wealth. These guys benefit a lot, okay? Why? Because they are not affected by the decline of investment. They are not affected by the decline of capital, okay? And they experience an increase in their wealth. And the equity return, the return from the wealth they have, has increased as well, okay? Who, on the other hand, is the guys that are low productivity, but they don't have asset holdings. They are the ones who lose more with this change, because investment is falling, so this has an effect on their wages, okay? And at the same time, they don't experience any increase in wealth because they have zero asset holdings, okay? So this is the welfare effect, and then that's why we defend that this type of monopoly power, but also changes in capital taxes should be studied in this heterogeneous agent setting, okay? Because you can analyze the effect on welfare on different agents according to their asset holdings. Okay, so in our paper, changes in Q have a direct effect on wealth, okay? Okay, because you are, if you are lowering taxes and you are increasing monopoly power, this is going to increase the asset price. But importantly, this has a negative and indirect effect on investment, okay? On factor prices, the return to equity is going to increase, the wages are going to decline, and on factor shares, the labor share, and the capital share and welfare, okay? Then in a companion paper, we show that these mechanisms are pretty much working at a global scale. So we see that there is empirical evidence that Torrens Q has a negative relation with the labor share, and this relation is driven by the factors that we analyze here for the US. Taxes on dividends and markups. And well, we can think in terms of all the potential drivers, okay, of Torrens Q, because the good thing about our model is that this crowding out effect of wealth, of financial wealth, that is depressing investment, here we analyze how this occurred through taxes and through monopoly power, but there are other potential drivers. Okay, so we have a section in the paper where we analyze the role of short-termism, and we show that short-termism is at the aggregate level is basically observationally equivalent to changes in monopoly markups. Okay, asset prices are going to rise and investment is going to fall, and the impact on inequality is pretty much the same. Okay. So in terms of policy, the paper has strong implications, because we saw that any change in capital income taxes, okay, that lowers the Torrens Q, okay, in this setting has a positive effect on capital formation, okay, and on equality. Okay, so there is this trade-off between the asset price and investment that we have shown in the paper. Okay, and in our paper, this is the case of dividend taxation, and it is also the case of corporate taxation when corporate taxes interact with monopoly rents. And this has a huge implication for the design of optimal tax policy. Okay, and so in a forthcoming paper with Brun, Lydia Brun, and Luis Rojas, we precisely study how to design optimal tax policy, optimal capital tax policy, in a setting where asset prices increase a lot thanks to monopoly or monopsony, thanks to rents in general. Okay. So this is the paper.
Really interesting presentation. I was wondering if you could, I had two questions. One, could you unpack a little the intuition for why capital gains and dividend taxes have different signs in terms of their effects on all the variables you're observing? And the second one is, you know, when you calculate those shareholder level taxes, do you take into account the declining share of corporate equity that's, you know, subject to those? Because, you know, a lot of it's now like in universities and stuff like that where, you know, it doesn't really matter what the statutory rate is, they don't pay it at all. And so that would...
I don't think I understood the second question.
Sorry. Yeah, so there's a larger share of corporate equity that's now owned by institutions that don't pay any shareholder level taxes.
Ah, okay, yeah.
And, you know, would that be, is that in the dividend in capital gains calculation or not?
Yeah, it is. Okay. I can answer. So regarding the first question, it's a very convenient question because I didn't have time to explain that our model, in our model, the firm maximizes the shareholder value, but we don't have stock buybacks. Okay, which is it's a way of distributing payouts from the firm to shareholders. So, I want to say two things regarding this. If we model the firm with the stock buybacks, which is not easy, again, we are working on that, then you would expect a similar effect of capital gains and taxes on dividends. Okay, so that is regarding the first question. What does that mean? It means that the impact of capital taxes, dividend, and capital gains on asset prices is even conservative in our model, because we are giving to because capital gains here are when the tax increase, okay, Tobin's Q is rising. When it falls, Tobin's Q is falling, okay. So in net terms, they go against our theory, okay. And still, we find that the joint effect of dividend taxation and capital gains transaction is very big, okay. In terms of rising asset prices and depressing capital output ratio and generating inequality. The second question, we in the paper we explain how we compute effective taxes on dividends and effective taxes on capital gains, and then we explain how we take into account the increase of accounts that are not taxable, like pension funds. We do that. Yeah, I want to say another thing about the, it's connected to your question a little bit, why we are being a conservative, not only with respect to capital gains tax, we are also being conservative with respect to the corporate tax rate. So the corporate tax rate in our economy, so here we have the corporate tax rate. So when we don't have interest deductibility in this model, okay? So interest deductibility exists, and now I know that it has been limited in the last tax reform, okay? But if you don't have interest deductibility, then a model like this is going to predict that when you lower the corporate tax rate, the capital output ratio investment is going to rise, and then capital inequilibrium is going to rise as well, okay? So we don't have interest deductibility, which means that the corporate tax rate, because it has declined, okay, it has two effects. On one hand, it's rising investment, okay, through the typical channel, because we don't have interest deductibility, even though in the US tax code we had interest deductibility, okay? On the other hand, the corporate tax rate has a negative effect because the corporate tax rate is driving Tobin's Q down. Okay, so it is driving the monopoly rent down, and then it's driving down Tobin's Q for the part explained by the monopoly rent. Okay, this has a negative effect on capital formation. So that part, that part of the change in the corporate tax has a positive effect on capital formation. In relative to the negative effect or to the positive effect of capital formation when the corporate tax rate is falling and increasing investment, I mean, we are giving more importance to this, or we are being very conservative because we are not considering interest deductibility. So in net terms, if we have interest deductibility, then the opposite effect of the corporate tax, which is going to reduce the monopoly rent and is going to have a positive effect on investment and capital formation, is going to be high. Okay, so why don't we have interest deductibility in this model? Well, this is a question that has to do with the fact that we wanted to have a simple structure, if we introduce corporate bonds and in this model, then we are forced to deal with an arbitrage condition between the taxes, between the interest rates and the equity returns. Okay, and we think this is we are working on that, but we are not satisfied by what we found in the literature, so we are still thinking on that. Yeah. Yes.
Do you have any observations based on this work about sectors where Q is outsized or substantially higher vis-a-vis other sectors? And specifically, I'm speaking about Mordecai Kurtz's recent work on surplus wealth.
Which recent work?
Mordecai Kurtz, he's at Stanford. He did a working paper on surplus wealth, and he specifically calls out tech and pharma. Where the Q is outsized, potentially driving the aggregate effect.
This is an aggregate model. I mean, we have monopolistic competition firms, but in equilibrium, I mean, all the firms are taking the same decision basically. But our model is consistent with cross-section data. So firms cross-section data. So of course, firms that are. I mean, this is. This is a little bit also connected to what the results in Gutierrez and Philippon paper, right, where they show that the firms that have like higher markups, higher monopoly power, among other things, they also present higher Tobin's Q. So Tobin's Q is a measure of profitability in terms of fundamentals, but I think sometimes the literature has forgotten that Tobin's Q is also a measure of monopoly power. Because any high value of Tobin's Q might be reflecting the fact that you are discounting the future monopoly rent that you are going to get, okay? And you are capitalizing the rent in your stock market price. So that's why Tobin's Q is higher in those sectors. Now, there are many measurement issues. So in reality, high Tobin's Q values can also be driven by, for example, intangible capital, okay? It is not that the stock market wealth is that high, is that perhaps you are not observing part of what you have in the denominator. So you are underestimating your denominator because part of the capital is unobservable. This is something that for sure is also, I mean, in my opinion, that is a potential driver of Tobin's Q as well. So at the aggregate level, what is the role of intangible capital on this story? So we have in this companion paper with my colleague Pedro Tribune, what we show is that when we calculate Tobin's Q using the available estimates of intangible capital, we find that the intangible capital doesn't explain basically the evolution of aggregate Tobin's Q.
So what are you using for your proxy for intangible?
I don't remember. This is the other paper. I mean, this is in the. It's a paper that is called The Global Rise of Asset Price and the Decline of the Labor Share. I mean, it's there.
All right. I think that's just about all. all of the time we have. Thank you all again for coming. I hope we'll see you on June 20th for the seminar with Heidi Williams. And thank you again to Ignacio for presenting this work.
Thank you.
What gets counted as capital?
What is counted as capital?
So is it reproducible asset?